Well, good afternoon or evening or morning or whatever clock it is in the part of the world where you are right now and when you are actually watching that. First of all, the most important part for those who are watching this live on this nice Saturday evening. As usual, there is a live chat embedded on the YouTube page, which if you're looking on the web interface, I think should be there. And if you are on the mobile app, it should be below. So if you have any questions over the course of this broadcast, just feel free to use this live chat and send them to me. And I just have to quickly switch off the preview, or otherwise I hear myself talking over the headphones. Hanging under my desk. So if you have any questions in the meantime, just write them there and I will look over there and try to answer them during the Q&A session, of course. And also if anything is wrong with the broadcast or something, just scream. I will hopefully be able to fix stuff as far as possible. Maybe a short outline of what we will be talking today. I'm stumbling a bit over my tongue today again. As usual, I will tell you what I've been up to the past couple of weeks, what I will hopefully be up to the next couple of weeks, and then we have our short Q&A segment with five questions that I picked from the spreadsheet and whatever you come up with in the live chat or some more questions from the spreadsheet, depending on how much time we have left then. And then I will briefly wrap things up and tell you when the next hangout will probably take place and all that. So what I've been up to since our last meeting, I think the most obvious thing should be that I released the OctoPrint version 1.3.0 on January the 25th, as I had hoped I would be doing during our last hangout. And the thing with this release is that after I put it out, I got a small handful of reports, so less than five, but I got some reports of issues after update to this version, that the server would be going offline randomly and I don't even know if it came up on its own after that or not, because the problem is that I got these reports that this issue is arising, but I did not get any more than that. So I asked the people, please give me logs and stuff like that, and try things out and report back what is happening. But I didn't get anything back on that. So if you are experiencing this problem, then please provide me with some information. Because I can't fix things that I cannot reproduce on my own. And also when I do not have any logs from people who are getting reproductions of errors. So in any case, when you run into any kind of problems with OctoPrint during updates or during regular operation or whatnot, feel free to either seek help on the mailing list, the Google Plus community, or even on the bug tracker. But if you use the bug tracker or in any way get in touch, please always provide as much information on your problem as possible, because it is utterly frustrating when I know that people are having problems with OctoPrint out there, but they do not tell me enough of what the problem is and how it manifests. And I mean, there are things in OctoPrint that take care of collecting information about stuff and writing them to the log. And that is also the reason why I always ask for logs on the ticket and why I always ask for the version number that you're running and for the browser you are using and for the printer that you're using and all that. This kind of information is not, I'm not asking for that in order to, I don't know, keep you busy while I twiddle my thumb and giggle maniacally or anything like that, but it's really necessary in order to be able to reproduce or understand your setup and ideally find your problem and fix it. So yeah, it's a bit like if you called your doctor and told him it hurts when you press here, but of course he can't see where here is, and then hang up with a please solve it. I can't. I don't know where it hurts, you know? So Just think of this when the next time that you run into a problem and need help with it. I need infos. I really want to help, but I can't without infos. Okay, with that out of the door, while the 1.3.1 release was already in the release candidate phase, I also did a bunch of fixes and improvements that will go into 1.3.2. So some stuff turned out to be buggy with the watched folder, for example, which gained ridiculously in popularity thanks to those recent video tutorials on YouTube that Joe Mike Terranella, I hope I get his name right, is putting out a really great tutorials. I try to remember to link to those in the video later on. And there were a couple of issues there, and I also finally found the solution to a problem that people were encountering with FFMPEG, which is used by OctoPrint to stitch together time lapses, producing videos that had garbled colors and weird distorted images and all that. And it turns out that there is apparently some unexpected behavior in FFmpeg with certain command line parameters, and I found a combination of command line parameters that doesn't seem to trigger that bug, so yay. I also refactored the JS client library a tiny bit, which is interesting for those of you who have been wanting or planning to use that for something like custom dashboard pages or so, where you connect to multiple OctoPrint instances, because the JS client library will now allow that. Interesting for those of you that are into single nozzle multi-extruder setups is that OctoPrint will now also support that, because so far you had the problem that you could specify that you have multiple extruders, but it's assumed that you also had multiple nozzles then and offered to lock temperatures for all that, and that it worked that way, but it looked weird. So now you can just, in your printer profile, you can just say shared nozzle, and then you will only have one temperature for your hot end and how many other extruders you configured. So this is interesting for stuff like the diamond hot end, or I think it was the E3D Cyclops, or maybe I'm mixing names up here, and of course the upcoming multi-extrusion upgrade that everyone is waiting for the Prusa i3 Mark II. Also, those of you who run Monoprice Maker Select, aka the Wanhao i3 printers, they run the repetitive firmware, and I recently discovered that they also seem to recommend, as part of the end gcode, to put into your slicer a routine which will basically have the printer sit there for 5 minutes, not accepting any commands anymore, while the nozzle is cooling down before the fan is turned off. Personally, I think having something like that in your NG code reeks a bit of a hardware design failure or something, and should rather be solved in the firmware, at least if solving it in hardware is not possible. But anyhow, this particular 5 minutes I'm doing nothing thumb twiddling routine, aka the G4 dual command in gcode, combined with a peculiar behavior in repetitive firmware, which those Wanhao aka Monoprice printers ship with, causes problems with OctoPrint, because it thinks that the G4 command, which is acknowledged by repetitive immediately when it is received, not when it is over, and then the printer doesn't respond for 5 minutes, and then OctoPrint thinks, printer seems to be dead. I have to, throw an error and disconnect and die. And this is something that I created a workaround in there. So that should hopefully with 1.3.2 also no longer happen, even though I still have to say, somehow that whole end gcode routine really feels weird. Before I continue in what I've been up to, one small intermission, because Frank in the chat just asked a stupid question about logs. Do we have somewhere a description how to extract them? Yes, it's all in the contribution guidelines. So when you open up a ticket on OctoPrint, there's a big yellow box on the top that tells you to please read the contribution guidelines, because they tell you what your bug report needs to contain in order to be processed and all that. And the same is also contained in the in the text field where you usually would write your bug report. So it's basically trying to lead you to the contribution guidelines to please read them, because in there is where to find the logs, where to find the version, the bug ticket template, which is also pre-populated for you and all that. So if there is any information lacking in that, please tell me, because then I will happily fix it. And otherwise, just follow it. It should hopefully help. Okay, back to 132. So basically, I did a number of things that I fixed a number of things that crept up since the first RC of 131 on the maintenance branch, and this is stuff that will go into the 132 release. What I also did is I finally started working on my long dreaded issue tracker cleanup. So I now am in the possession of a very, very long Excel sheet, which I dumped an export from all the issues, all the open issues on the GitHub issue tracker in, clustered them by general topic and also identified a bunch of duplicates already that I closed, and also a couple of other things that I could immediately handle. And right when I was getting to somewhere there, so when I really had the feeling, hey, now I'm finally going to do that cleanup, I was basically thrown on my back by what I'm now calling the nasty cold of doom, which meant for me that 2 weeks of the past 4 weeks were lost to sneezing and coughing and not being able to think properly, which is also why I did not dare to touch anything OctoPrint related. Past experiences have shown then when my head is feeling as it was feeling the last two weeks, then anything that I write, I will probably have to delete later. Or even worse, I break stuff that I refactor things, and then I have to also throw that away as well. So not generally not a good idea to have me working on stuff I have to think about then. So now, thankfully, since Sunday, so last week, so for the past work week, so to speak, I'm thankfully back on my feet. I'm still slightly wobbly a bit, but the brain is working fine again, I hope. At least I think so. And I'm still working through all those things that came in during this involuntary break of mine. So if you wrote me an email or opened a pull request or a bug report or tried otherwise to reach me over the course of the past 2 or 3 weeks, I'm not ignoring you, I'm just still trying to catch up. Which brings me to my next step. So, processing whatever else is there still on my stack to be processed from my timeout, and also getting 1.3.2 finalized over the next weeks, and then, of course, and a release candidate of that. And that brings me to something I also want to say is that the more people really that help me test those RCs, the less risk there is of any bugs making it into mainstream. So if you're watching this and are hearing about the release candidates for the very first time, maybe think about if you want to help testing them. It's really painless. It's just in OctoPrint you can easily switch over. There's some info on every release candidate blog announcement that I do on how to do that. So when you see that, then maybe think if you want to help test that, because it really helps in identifying any issues before they hit everyone. And I also really need to get back on the issue tracker. And for those of you who are pledging on Patreon at $3 level, you might remember the survey that I did over the course of December. I still haven't found the time to tackle the full evaluation of that one. I'm really working on getting there too. Speaking of which, these days, I have to say, I really feel a bit like a hamster in a wheel with OctoPrint. And to counter that, I've decided, and I hope you will not rip my head off for that, to reduce the release rate a bit. So the past year or even more than that, I've been doing new releases roughly every month. And the thing is that considering the amount of maintenance and of support requests that I get, and generally of stuff that shoots at me from the sites, right now I cannot keep up this pace when I actually also want to do new features for 1.4.0 basically. So the larger things that keep me busy a couple of days or even weeks on one at a time, to wrap my head around and get properly done. So the idea is now to just reduce the release rate a bit to give me some more air to breathe, because every release also eats at least half a day, even more, depending on how many release candidates I have to put out and how long the release notes are that I need to write and all that. And then let's see if that maybe helps. The problem really is that one person doing all that is a bit tricky to stay ahead of things if you also try to do monthly releases. So yeah, that were the next steps. So let's get to the Q&A section now. And as mentioned earlier, feel free to just dump whatever you have, those of you who are watching this live, dump whatever questions you have in mind now also into the chat, and I will get to them once I've gone through the couple of questions that I've prepared beforehand. All right. So one question from our little Q&A sheet by Christian is, do you think we need a specific profile for the Prusa i3 Mark II? I configured something manually in OctoPrint just in case I will ever want to slice in OctoPrint. So I'm not entirely sure how this question was meant, as in, do we need to include this printer profile by default in OctoPrint, or what specifically he meant there. But in general, I try to leave any printer specifics out of OctoPrint, which I guess is pretty obvious by now, because otherwise stuff gets unmaintainable quite fast, because you have so many printers out there trying to cater to all of them with their specifics, like how many nozzles, layer size, blah blah, and all that. It's just too much. So profiles of any kind is something that I would like to not ship with OctoPrint. But what might be really interesting, I think, for the general user base is something like maybe a profile hub. So if you know that you have a printer, something like a Prusa i3 Mark II, then OctoPrint would offer you some way to select that from a list, and then you would not have to enter all that information on your own. Because right now, of course, I mean, it's a bit of work, actually, because I think now we have three separate panes in the printer profile settings. And yeah, while that gives you a lot of flexibility if you have a self-built printer, if you have one that is, you know, like a commercial kit or something that is always the same, then it would probably make sense to make it easier to import other people's settings or even just select something from a list. So as I just mentioned, I'm currently not entirely sure where my head is all the time because of all the tasks that I have on my plate. So while I really like that idea, I do not know when I will be able to get around to do it. But if someone else wants to give this a shot, I mean, you're basically looking at something similar to the plugin repository on OctoPrint, which in fact is a static website compiled from a couple of Jekyll files hosted on GitHub. So it's not some huge development effort. It's just a bit of work setting everything up and then integrating with OctoPrint. What I would offer here is, if anyone wants to give this a shot, I would happily help integrate it with OctoPrint, because this is something that would help. I could even happily host it. So I just cannot promise when I will get around to doing something like that. I do not think that something like that would make much sense for slicer profiles, but maybe I'm mistaken there. Personally, I think I've never used slicing profiles as provided by the vendor in my life so far. I've always just looked at the print settings and maybe maybe looked at the official profiles a bit, but I never directly used them because, yeah, I don't know. I have to admit, I do not even trust Windows that much. But I don't know, maybe you're of a different opinion, and yeah, we can surely talk about stuff. Yeah, another question from an anonymous user, or at least I do not have a name in my notes here, sorry if I forgot that, is what do you think about the multi-material upgrade from Prusa? I already mentioned that the next OctoPrint version 1.3.2 should support, I mean, should also visually support this kind of setup. And personally, I think it looks like a really cool upgrade. I've not seen it in person or anything. I'm just judging by what's out there on the web. While I added this support for single nozzle and shared nozzle setups in OctoPrint, since I do not have some kind of multi-material upgrade with a shared nozzle myself on that printer, and it would also not fit that one because this is not a Prusa, I am really looking forward to feedback from the community once the thing is out, because I've now basically simulated it in my virtual printer that I use for development, but I'm not entirely sure if what I simulated there matches the real world. So if once that thing hits the mainstream, please try it with OctoPrint with the shared nozzle setting and tell me if stuff looks all right or not. Another question, and I also did not write a name there. I think I forgot it. Sorry for whoever sent in the next question. Do you think it would be possible to send the print progress to the LCD screen? Yes, it already is, actually, because right now in the plugin repository, there are not only one, but two display progress plugins. One is called Display Progress, that's mine. The other one is called Detail Progress by Datas, and both of them utilize the M117 gcode command, which is basically send the text that follows the command and display it on the printer's LCD. In order to find those, you can just search for progress either on plugins.octoprint.org or in the repository, in the built-in plugin manager repository view. So there is a bit of a problem with those two plugins because, or rather not with the plugins, but with some printers, because there are some printers out there that do not display what you send to the printer via M117. I know of, I think it was actually one of the Wanhao printers as well. Or was it? I'm not entirely sure. But some of those cheap Chinese ones, at least, you can send what you want by via M117. They will not display it on the display anywhere. So if you run into a problem like that, then I fear you'll have to figure out how to do it with your printer. Either adjust one of the plugins or ask nicely for them to be adjusted. Another problem is that some of the printers out there also have fancy graphical progress bars, and that are used to display the progress of the print for something like SD print. But when you then print from OctoPrint, those progress bars either do not show up at all, or they show up but stay at zero or something like that. And the problem with those progress bars is that, there is no standard for communicating the fillage percentage of progress bars like that. So I know that Repetier firmware recently added a handful of commands for controlling such a built-in progress bar. I think M530, M531, and M532, but as far as I know, that is not available on Marlin yet, and yeah, so it's a bit tricky in such special cases right now, since no standard way to control those specific progress bars built into the firmware that would allow to write a plugin that works with every printer out there. So this is a bit of experimentation that is still necessary by people who have printers like that, and either fixing the plugins accordingly so that they also work with those, or at least helping the authors of the progress plugin, so me or Datas, to make stuff work, or even writing a whole new plugin. So for now, I guess the common base to send any kind of information to the printer's LCD to display will have to stay M117, because at least that is pretty much standard across all firmwares, and everything else is just too fragmented and one little standard, another little standard. Now we have 15 competing standards and everyone does it slightly differently. I could now go endlessly on my soapbox about the state of firmware land and how difficult it is for hosts to develop something that works with everything under the sun out there, but just leave it at things being complicated now. Another question, or the next question by Christian, another Christian this time though. Rename feature. I use Slicer direct export feature to push the gcode files to the Pi. Unfortunately, I cannot give a name for such files as these are generated on the fly. Therefore, it would be nice to be able to rename the prints at any time. An extension would be some sort of virtual file system or something similar to manage the prints hierarchically and so on. So, first thing would be the renaming, I guess, and that is actually already possible. Not directly within OctoPrint, or rather not directly within core OctoPrint, but you can just install the file manager plugin by Salandora from the plugin repository, and that will allow you not only to rename files, but also to move them into the folders and move the folders around or copy stuff and all that. And also to stream stuff to SD, if you have the patience for that, because this is a slow process. So yeah, maybe this is of interest for you. And this file manager plugin is actually a really, really great thing. And I also already thought about maybe bundling it directly with OctoPrint, if Salandora agrees, of course. But I'm still undecided because anything that is bundled then also is more tricky to maintain outside of the release cycles of OctoPrint. So I'm still thinking about it. The other thing is, for some more organization options, I also thought about something like adding tags or something like that, and extending the search within OctoPrint to search for tags. So you would not need something like a virtual file system, but rather just additional metadata that would be attached to your files, so you could easily find them. If the hierarchies of the folders are not enough. But that would probably be a plugin. Because, it makes a lot of sense for most people, maybe, or maybe even, I don't know if even for most, but it makes sense for people. But I'm always a bit reluctant, as I explained last time, to stuff too much stuff into the core of OctoPrint due to all the, maintenance and the coupling and all that. So, that was the last of my 5 questions that I had prepared before, and so now I will look into the live chat and see if there is anything in there. But apparently so far nothing. So then I guess I'll just leave you some time to think of something, those of you who are watching that live. And in the meantime, get to a couple of other questions that I've prepared, because we still have some time here. So, another question that was sent in beforehand by Marcus is it possible to keep multiple versions of OctoPrint on the system to be able to use the stable version and additionally test the release candidate and devil branches without the need for 2 or 3 recipes? And the answer to that is pretty simple. It's yes, of course, it's completely possible. The only thing is that you need a bit of manual setup, because there is no button in OctoPrint that will allow you to do that. So you basically have 2 options there. You can have multiple checkout folders with their own virtual environment within the checkout folder, basically checked out to various branches or or the release candidates or whatever your heart desires to test, and then just installing those into the own virtual environment and starting them from there. And the other would be just creating a couple of virtual environments and then switching the checkout folder to wherever you want and installing it into the virtual environment and switching back. The thing is that, the checkout folder, the version that is in the checkout folder is not necessarily the one that is also installed in your virtual environment. So you always have to sync those up, and that gives you a bit more flexibility with regards to how you manipulate multiple OctoPrint instances. In general, it's absolutely no problem to run multiple instances of OctoPrint, whether it be the same version or another version or whatever, because OctoPrint has a couple of command line switches that simply allow you to bind to a different port and also to use a different folder for all its data configuration and such stuff. So all you need to do is basically fire up the main instance the usual way, and then just fire up the second instance with something like --port 5001 instead of 500, which is the standard port, and --bastier, and then something like maybe not homepy.octoprint but homepy.octoprint2, and then everything will just work. On OctoPy, you will have to you might have to also adjust the reverse proxy, because that is already set up in there, so that you could have something like octopy.local/ going to your usual instance, and then octopy.local/ I don't know, maintenance or something going to your maintenance version. But in theory, that is definitely possible, and actually it's something that I do all the time, because I keep switching between the versions. I have a couple of checkouts on the same devil machine that I work on daily, in various states, and that I can quickly fire up and all that. But as I said, it requires you to do some stuff on the command line, because basically this is such a complicated thing to do from a UI, from an already running process, and error prone to do in a semi-automatically way, that it is not something that I would build into OctoPrint directly, as much as I see the charm in that maybe. But yeah, I mean, that would just open a can of worms that will probably swallow me up or something like that. Okay. Now there are questions in the live chat. Yay. First question by JulemS is, any chance to support the Ultimaker 3? Yes and no. So I have to explain it a bit, I think. The thing is that OctoPrint's current communication layer, and I think I've mentioned that in past broadcasts too, is very, very focused on serial connections, and the UM3 does not use serial. And and in order to change that, I need to basically rip out the whole communication layer and redo it in a way that allows to have one communication layer basically for serial communication, like today, immediately split up a bit between firmware versions, because right now trying to do all that stuff from one is mind-boggling, and also allow something like TCP connections or some JSON-based protocol or stuff like that. So something like a custom interface to a 3D printer like the UM3, for example, which I think you can only upload files to and then call some API to start a print and to get some print progress and all that, and that's that. So there's no way to send custom commands, I think. I might be mistaken. I only briefly looked into how they implemented the client basically in Cura. I've been meaning to do something like what I just said, so ripping out the current communication layer and replacing it with a modular version for roughly 2.5 years now. The thing is that Well, the first version I had completely scrapped because I discovered a couple of bugs in current firmwares that killed my whole approach that I had to solve this. The second one I started about a year ago, and then this thing with the funding and OctoPrint's sponsorship and the whole financial approach kind of hit me, and I just fully focused on getting 1.3.0 out and trying to figure out how to continue in all that, because I didn't know how much longer I could get on. And so I still have what I worked on back then, and it printed, so it was actually quite nice already. I just have to see that I get that merged to the current development branch again, and see if in the past year basically things changed on the comm layer that nix that approach again, or that allow me to continue to use it, because I really want to get this modular approach going finally. Actually, I hope to have it in 1.4.0, but please do not nail me down on that, because I might discover the next problem with firmware behavior that again nukes something there. So if I had something like that in place in OctoPrint, also extendable through plugins, of course, that would make it possible to write a plugin specifically for the Ultimaker 3. I do not have an Ultimaker 3, so that would need to be done by someone who has one. Because writing a plugin to talk to a printer that you do not have and cannot test against, no, this is not going to work. This is so not going to work. So, but I want to make, I want to at least create the base that allows that. So, now I have to read up a bit on the chat again to see what next. Christian says, why you use only half of the web page to display info? If you use full page, you can see temperature page and control page in same time, or control and viewer. This is funny that this comes up now. I guess you read the discussion on the Patreon. The thing is that back when I created OctoPrint, and basically what is now OctoPrint's UI, that was roughly 4 years ago, I did not expect that it would gain this much of popularity at all. I wrote this thing, I created the UI the way I created the UI, I pushed it out, and suddenly thousands of people were using it. And that was like, okay. The problem is that I did a couple of things in there that, that are tricky to do with a fully responsible UI. So basically, the way that a lot of the components of OctoPrint work today, they would not scale that well. And also the whole UI as it is now would really need to be restructured in order to be fully responsive. And this is something that, after I introduced plugins that can also inject themselves into the UI, became even more complicated. So now it's not only a lot of work to a medium amount of work to build a new UI, which even would probably be easier now that we have the JavaScript client library, which I could also use myself in order to quickly get something up and running. But I also have to think about backwards compatibility all the time. So if there is some fancy plugin now that injects a tab into OctoPrint and that has some complicated layout in there and fancy graphs and all that stuff, and I now do it completely differently, locate the part where it injects itself somewhere else where the size changes or can change depending on which device you are running on and all that, stuff will break. And this is something that I have to take into consideration. So my current idea to go about this is basically writing a new UI next to the existing one, and basically offering separate hooks in there so that a plugin author could, during some longish migration phase, first only support the old one, the current one, and then once it becomes stable, add stuff to support the new one so that his plugin can work in both modes, and also offering the user in that case some way to switch between the two, because just shutting off the old one and completely replacing it like a big bang basically with a new one, which would be totally fancy and funny, and I would probably also find myself some designer for that, because I mean I am a coder, right? Is something that will just break stuff all around, and that will not make you happy, I think, none of you. None of you who use any kind of UI plugin. So that is the problem right now. I am aware that I'm wasting a lot of space basically on the current UI on the left and the right. There's nothing that right now I can easily do to solve that. I'm aware that people find this painful and want to see it solved, and I am thinking about it a lot and brainstorming a lot, and it's definitely on my roadmap, but I cannot like solve it tomorrow. I'm sorry for that. And one thing though is, if you have problems with how things are arranged and how things are combined in there, the way the current UI is made allows to basically take something like the control tab and the temperature tab and merge them into one. You could basically, put the temperature over the control, or the other way around, and have it all merged. You could also create your own tab replacing the two existing tabs that put stuff differently in there in a way that works for you. The possibilities are there. They are actually also documented. I think there's even a proof of concept of how to merge. No, that was a proof of concept of how to put the file section into its own tab. But if that works, you could also figure out how the other thing works. I'll also happily answer any questions with regards to how to implement something like that with the current approach. The possibilities are there. The problem, of course, is that someone has to do it. And as mentioned above, I think considering my time constraints and that right now I'm already struggling to keep up with everything that's hammering from all sides on me, I think it makes more sense to rather concentrate on a big picture and think about how to get a new UI concept going that is responsive and modern and allows you maybe also way more configuration than the current one, instead of spending time on rearranging things and offering plugins to rearrange things. That's at least my view. I do not know if you agree with that, but I think it just makes more sense to prioritize it that way. There is still another question from Thomas. Why don't you provide a complete image for the Raspberry Pi, including OctoPrint? I tried it with the latest Raspbian following your guide and failed. I'm a bit confused actually about that question, because that is what is OctoPi, what OctoPi is all about. It's not actually my project. It's a project by Guy Schaeffer, but we talk to each other. And OctoPi is basically a complete image for the Raspberry Pi, including OctoPrint, including MJPEG streamer, including HA proxy in front of everything, so that all of that is accessible via port 80. And so maybe I'm just misunderstanding the question there, but you might want to check out OctoPi. Also, sorry in case I'm sounding a bit rough. I'm my throat is a bit acting up right now. Okay, more questions. Thomas just reiterated that OctoPie includes an old version of Raspberry. Well, you can update that version via apt-get update. And I also need to talk to Guy because it's time to put out a new image. But the problem is that this might not be obvious, but we do not get any kind of support directly from Raspberry Pi. So whenever they put out a new image, we do not get anything like a fair warning before. We do not get hardware. We do not get an insight into what goes into that image. We have to test all that stuff. And Guy has a full-time job going with others, with his startup. And yeah, I also have my hands full with OctoPrint. So far, our basic approach was, or at least my understanding of our basic approach was, as long as it works with the hardware that is on the market, and you can update over the air everything that is on there, because this is how the package management in Raspbian works, and OctoPrint also allows you to update it over the air thanks to OctoPrint's built-in update mechanism. There should be no problem, because you also do not, in the Linux world, you do not all the time, basically refresh your server or something like that when there is a new version of Debian out. You just upgrade it. If something goes wrong during that upgrade process, like Thomas just now wrote in the chat, then it would probably help to report on that, because then we can maybe work around that problem. And just putting an image out every time that Raspbian design or the Raspberry Pi people decide to update their image, usually without any meaningful changelog, by the way, that just doesn't scale, because we would need to test every new image if there are any kind of problems and all that. And with the one that we have right now, we at least know it works. Additionally, there are always also some weird changes that they do to the images that you then have to spend weeks around trying to figure out why stuff stopped working on that specific image now. And the only advice that I can give you right now is, when you want to run it on a Raspberry Pi, use OctoPi. If you have problems updating the Raspbian version running on OctoPi, then please get in touch. In that case, please on the bug tracker of OctoPi, because OctoPrint, while it has something to do with OctoPi, it is not OctoPi. It is a completely different project, and I and the bug tracker in OctoPrint for OctoPrint is not the right location to report bugs on with OctoPi image. And that will hopefully help Guy and me also, because I also try to help where I can with that project. To solve the issue, to identify the issue, and if it's not solvable, it will be a huge hint to that we need to do a new release of OctoPi. But if we do not know about that, well, you know, as usual, it's really the same for OctoPi and for OctoPrint. When you run into an issue, please tell us. I cannot solve things I do not know about. It's as simple as that. And you wouldn't imagine how frustrating it is sometimes. Anyhow, Frank says, as much as I want to test release candidates and even the developer version, my two Octos seem to update only on stable. That said, I had it switched in the settings. Yeah, well, that sounds like something is wrong there, because it shouldn't do that. I definitely have maybe some words on how I usually do my my release tests. So what I do every time that I put out a new release candidate or a new release is I do multiple flashes of OctoPi, put each one into a specific base state. So one is freshly flashed, not even the first time run wizard in OctoPrint is run and stuff. Another one is the version of OctoPrint set up already, that comes with OctoPy, I think that's still 1 to 10 or something. Then I also have one that is flashed to the current stable version before the version I roll out. And the last one, depending on if I'm testing with release candidates or not, I also then test against tracking the stable branch, tracking the maintenance RC, and tracking the devil branch. So something like 5, maybe more OctoPy instances. And then for each of those, I test the update. So far, I've never rolled out a release where I noticed any problem there, because of course I would fix the problem first before I roll out the release. If you run into any issues, so for example, if you are running now 1.31 and you switch to the maintenance release channel, then it will tell you you are on the newest version because I do not have yet put out a 1.3.2 release candidate. But once I put that out, you should get a notification about that when you're tracking that channel. If you then update to that, you will be running 1.3.2 on the release channel, on the maintenance release channel. If you switch back to master, it will actually downgrade you back to 1.3.1 again. The same with the devil RC. So switching between the release channels will actually tell you, oops, I need to upgrade or I need to downgrade you, as long as there is a different version on those channels available than the one you're currently running. When you want to test out the actual development branches, so either the maintenance branch or the devil branch, you will not be able to do that via the settings within OctoPrint, because those are only allow you to switch between release channels. But then you need to do that on a command line with a bit of git checkout branch name, and then basically reinstalling OctoPrint into the virtual environment and restarting the server. And then it should on startup, it should basically show you the correct version. If something is wrong there, please tell me with logs and all that stuff, and also tell me what you did in order to switch branches and all that, so that we know that we can find out what is wrong there, basically. Okay. Another look in the chat, but I think that was all that we had. Oh. And considering that we nearly filled up an hour already, unless there is nothing pressing right now that pops up in the chat, I will just get started a bit with my wrap up. I can always still quickly jump back into answer mode. And the next hangout. Yeah, so basically, I think there will be sometime in the next 4 weeks, or rather, so when I look into the calendar, let me quickly look where that would land us. Yeah, somewhere around March 18th, 19th, 20th, maybe even exactly that weekend. I have to look into my own calendar that I do not have any issues there with private appointments. And this hangout and the last one, they were during my evenings and were rather targeted at the Western Hemisphere. The next hangout I will schedule during my early morning hours again, so that the Eastern Hemisphere also gets a chance. That should be afternoon for them, and that would be late night for the Western Hemisphere, so US and stuff. After the next one, we will go back to evening for me, late night for Eastern, morning, noon for Western, and then again a survey, and then repeat and repeat and repeat that. So personally, I think that it's probably the fairest approach to give everyone a chance to attend those meetings, having some fixed at one time zone, having another fixed at another time zone, catch all segments, so to speak, and then allowing everyone to vote on the third part of the cycle. That would be that. You did not throw in any, oh my god, I still have a question, please, emergency kind of thing in the chat, then I guess we will really wrap this up now and call it an evening, give my throat some time to to recover. I wish you a nice rest of the day, however long it may be where you are. And thank you for attending or for watching, depending on if you did this live or later on as part of the recording. I'll try to put up the edited together recording and tagged recording of that broadcast sometime during the next week. I'll have to look though if I can make that, but yeah, I'll try to, you know. And then I guess have fun and happy printing and all that, and I guess we will hopefully see each other again in something like 4 weeks, or at least in the broadcast, in the recording of that. All right, take care and bye.